Today we have one of the authors, honorary doctor of ISM University of Management and Economics, the laureate of Nobel Prize in Economics, Professor Robert Shiller, visiting us repeatedly. We're very grateful and happy. However, before I give the word to Professor Shiller, I would like to invite here Professor Stasys Jakeliūnas, one of the leading Lithuanian economists who has played a profound role in having this book translated and published here in Lithuania. So Professor Jakeliūnas, please tell us a few words about the process.
Thank you, Vincent. I must correct the mistakes. So already two you made. I'm not a professor. I'm not an economist. I'm very interested in economics, and especially cognitive economics, as Professor Shiller writes the books about. When I was initiating this project, it came to my mind that this is about manipulation and deception. At that time, last year in October, I was involved in planning to write about manipulation and deception in Lithuanian politics, about how many forms of psychological manipulation we have. So it seemed, it looked like this book is right on target. My thesis on political manipulation never came true yet, but this project took hold, and thanks to several people I'd like to mention here, this materialized and this book is published last week before our professor's visit here. So first, I would like to thank Ramūnas Karbauskis and the foundation Švieskime Vaikus, who is the sponsor of this project. And I think this is very important to have our universities, colleges, and schools, that they would have this book available to have a new look at the economics as such. Then Linas Andronovas, the translator of this book, who took this challenge and managed it quite well. Editor Mindaugas Karatsėjus, who worked together with us and managed the language complications, which we had many, starting with the title of the book, which took 4 months to translate. At the end of the book only, the title was translated. And then the designers of the book, Daumantas Každailis, who managed to come with the idea of the cover of this book. You'll see how interesting and original it is. And Ieva Každailienė, who managed the designing of the whole text. So please join me in thanking these people working hard in bringing this this book to life here today. Thank you, Professor Robert Shiller, for coming to present this book, and I think we will have a chance to work together, if not ourselves, maybe this university or other universities, because there are more books to be translated into Lithuanian. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Stasys, for your comments and for displaying firsthand the ability of manipulating people into believing that you're an economist. As for Professor, I decided to err on the side of caution. On a more serious note, I would like now to give the floor to Professor Robert Shiller, who's going to introduce his book, after which we're going to have opportunity to ask questions from the audience.
Well, thank you for these introductions. It's nice to be back at the ISM University again. It was 3 years ago that this event occurred. I was coming here right after winning the Nobel Prize, and I brought my whole family with me, and it was a great occasion. I'm honored to have this connection to ISM. And I wanted to thank Švieskime Vaikus. I actually speak Lithuanian. I'm sorry, it may not seem that way. Foundation for publishing a Lithuanian translation of my book. So actually, I am 100% Lithuanian because, well, at least all four of my grandparents came from Lithuania about 110 years ago. That's a long time. And they joined a Lithuanian community in the United States. The USA is not really a melting pot. It's all these little communities. And so that's why my parents met. They were both Lithuanian. And here I am. not many of my relatives speak Lithuanian anymore, so it's been a long time. But it feels like I'm coming home. I kind of grew up with Lithuanian stories. One that was particularly prominent was that we were somehow royalty, because there was my mother's maiden name was Radvilaita, and we thought we were descended from the Queen of Poland, Lithuanian Queen of Poland. But it can't be, I realize, because she died childless, so it's a family story. Anyway, it does feel like homecoming to be back in Lithuania and getting such a great reception here. So I'm here to talk about my book with George Akerlof, called Kvailiu Žvejona. That's Phishing for Fools. I should introduce my co-author Akerlof is sort of local. His on one side of his family from Sweden, and if you ever go to the Stockholm train station, you can see still there, I'm told, paintings on the wall that his grandfather painted. So that's sort of local. You think of it as local here? Baltic. So anyway, what is our book about? We invented a strange title for it. We had a little trouble with our American publisher at first. It sounds funny in English, too. The word phishing refers to, it's a new word in English. It's only about 20 years old. It was invented, the word appeared in the 1990s to refer to a kind of internet scam where they steal your identity by tricking you. So we're using it as a metaphor more broadly, referring to manipulation and deception, not just on the internet. And we were being a little bit cute with our word for fool. We misspelled it deliberately. In case you're wondering, it is not normally spelled P-H-O-O-L. We did the funny spelling because we thought, well, maybe we have a slightly different word idea here than is conveyed by the English language word F-O-O-L. We're talking about smart people or normal people who don't realize how much they're being deceived. So we call that sort of person a fool with the PH. So what motivated this book was an idea that George and I kind of independently came up with. It's not even original with us, but it's a continuation of a mode of thought that hasn't penetrated, we thought, economist thinking. And the idea is very simple, that it's not totally unfamiliar to anyone, I suppose, but we proceed by giving multiple examples to establish the ubiquity of the issue we're talking about. The key idea in the book is something we call a phishing equilibrium. And the idea is that we live in a world where we live in a world where so many people are practicing mild manipulation, not outrageous or totally dishonest manipulation. So many people do it that it becomes excusable. And not only excusable, but also necessary. If you live in a world where other people are pursuing business strategies that are manipulative, commonplace manipulative, you know you won't go to jail for it because it's not really against the law. And you know that everyone else is doing it. So you probably do it too. I give you a very simple example of a phishing equilibrium. About 20 or 30 years ago in the United States, there was a kind of consumer movement. I say kind of. It was in a number of newspapers complaining about stores, especially grocery stores, a habit of placing candy right by the cash register where you check out. People complained that this is difficult. They're shopping maybe with young children, and the children are impatient and want to leave. And then the last part is the worst. Now you have to stand in line waiting to pay for the food. And the child is at its worst at that point. And what do? They put candy right there in front of you. So it was considered a devious trick. So as a result, you know, for a while, there was this was long ago, there was a public outcry against it. So some stores said, we won't do that anymore. We'll put vegetables there or something else. And that lasted for a few years. But if you go now, it's back. In fact, even worse, they even have it arranged often that children's candy is at children's eye level. So why do they do that? Are they evil? It sounds like, you know, candy isn't good for kids. Why do they do that? Well, almost never do they not do that. I don't know, I haven't looked in Lithuania whether you do this here.
We do.
We do. But if you think about the morality of it and the issues, imagine that you were manager of a grocery store. Now, one thing that is not maybe widely appreciated, but once you're in the business, you figure out pretty fast, it's a highly competitive business. All the other grocery stores are selling the same stuff pretty much. And people switch, you know, they're watching prices. So it drives your profit margins down very low. So you might have like a 2% profit margin if everything is okay. You become really neurotic about this. You've got to do everything. You're responsible for this business. People's jobs are here. You know, you think, well, maybe I shouldn't play this trick on my customers. But you know, you're going to do it, right? You're going to play the same trick because the morality has already been diminished by the fact that everybody else does it. Now, at least in America, I noticed they do this not just at food stores, but at any kind of store. I was shopping in a hardware store, and they had candy right there at the checkout. Amazing. Shouldn't be amazing. This is phishing equilibrium. And if it happens, if it's there to make a profit and it's not reprehensible, it's not something that will get you into trouble, it will be there. So we think of the free market system as a system that puts pressure on companies to perform. And the idea has been that the more pressure on people, if they're not pressured, they get lazy. And you put pressure on them, and then they innovate. I think that's true, and that's part of the power of free markets. Unfortunately, it also puts pressure on them to innovate in other ways that might be devious. So let me say something more about the thrust of this book. Some people describe this as a scholarly trade book. So a trade book is that's the jargon of publishing, is a book aimed for the general public. It's not scholarly. And then there are scholarly books that they have mathematics in them and they have voluminous references. But ours is halfway between, so it's scholarly trade, which means that we have no mathematics in it, and we put all of the footnotes at the end so you can ignore them if it disturbs you to see scholarly footnotes. But also our language is more accessible. So some people think that that means that the book isn't serious. And here I think I disagree. We disagree. We think of this as just as serious a book as anything that we have written. It's a serious book because, well, now to economists, the idea that there's manipulation and deception is not new. It's known, certainly known. And the idea that one would write a book emphasizing the importance of something rather than just the idea is kind of unacademic. But I think that the whole academics, thinking particularly of economics, it's drifting away from an exclusive reliance on pure theory. If you go back to a economics department, say 50 years ago, you'd find that there was a tendency, an attitude to think that mathematical economics is the thing. Also computer models, they would call them then. You'd have these high-speed IBM 360 computers, and it would be churning out forecasts of the economy. So everything seemed science and high-techy. And pure theorists were the most admired. But I think that has changed now. And I'm right now a president of the American Economic Association, so I had the opportunity to organize our annual meetings this January. And we had about 5,000 papers submitted. Looking over them all, it seems to me that the econ profession is getting more and more practical and down to earth. I think it's not just economics, perhaps. There were a couple of recent books by physicists. One was something called The Trouble with Physics by Lee Smolin. And there was another book called Not Even Wrong by Peter Voigt. So what were they talking about? They were talking about a problem they saw in modern physics. That, to quote Voigt, everybody wants to be Einstein. Okay. Part of what motivates us is that a phenomenon called theory-induced blindness, which means that when you have a theory, you tend to see everything through the lens of that theory, and you think everything is... You see evidence as confirming the theory. This is something that you have to resist because it's a characteristic human error. So we thought that there's a sort of theory-induced blindness at work in economics as well. By the way, the term, is that a familiar term to you? Maybe not. Nice thing about the internet now is you can track down when terms appeared. So it's not that old. Doing a ProQuest search or a LexisNexis search, theory-induced blindness appeared in the English language around 2012. That's only about 4 years ago. And it's traceable to a wonderful book written by the psychologist Danny Kahneman. You know this book? Called Thinking Fast and Slow. It's kind of the culmination of his life's work. So he warned people to avoid theory-induced blindness. You learn a lot of theories in school, but be always open and aware of things that might not coincide with the theory. I was wondering how far back theory-induced blindness goes with another name. The other name for it is something called confirmation bias. It means that you always see things as confirming your theories. And Wikipedia has an entry on confirmation bias and gives the history of that one. Wikipedia claims the idea was generated by Thucydides in 400 BC. So I think there really is a confirmation bias, and it's something that that we have to think more about. So let's talk about economic theory and how it has developed over the last century. First of all, there was the famous book by Adam Smith in 1776 called The Wealth of Nations, which is a wonderful book. It still reads very well. It's still useful reading. But then 100 years later, with Leon Walras and others, it started to become mathematical. And that has continued to this day. The mathematical economics took great moral authority, I would say, with the discovery of Vilfredo Pareto, who was an Italian-Swiss economist at Lausanne University in Switzerland, who developed a concept called Pareto optimality. And he showed with some mathematical flair that in an ideal competitive economy, with everyone watching out for his or her self-interest, things actually work out perfectly in a certain sense. The sense is that in a competitive free market equilibrium, it is impossible to make everyone better off. You can make some people better off, but only at the expense of making somebody else worse off. It's a simple idea. If everyone's making deals and trading, they've already reached some sort of optimum, and any redistribution is only going to, it has to hurt somebody. Beautiful mathematics. It later became known as the fundamental theorem of welfare economics and is taught widely. What it leads to, though, if you just look at it simplistically, is the idea that everyone is, the best thing for the government to do is stay out and do nothing. The free competitive system will reach perfection. Now that is a rather extreme view, and although the mathematics is beautiful, it's not the whole truth. And Vilfredo Pareto's theory soon came under criticism at the beginning of the 20th century. I think the most famous critic of Pareto's theory was Vilfredo Pareto himself, because he later disavowed it. And in fact, he got so fed up with economics, he dropped out completely and became a sociologist. So what was wrong with Pareto optimality, according to Pareto? And it was that people don't really get it right, that there's something human shortcomings that lead them to make mistakes. So it's not obvious that the competitive solution is optimal. I like to refer to a paper written in 1918. You can see I'm big on history of thought here. But 1918 is, my relatives were already in the USA. It's not that long ago. 1918, Irving Fisher from my university, Yale University, wrote an article criticizing the foundations of economic theory. And the idea of economic theory, that people maximize their utility. So the idea is everybody has a utility function and which maps their consumption bundle into their happiness. And they're consistently maximizing that, subject to a budget constraint. You've heard this, I assume. So Irving Fisher said, you know, this isn't the people that I know who may have problems of self-control, they're distractible and influenceable by what others seem to be doing. They don't know how to maximize the utility function. And then Irving Fisher said, you know, on top of it, I don't like this word utility. Somebody was manipulating us who invented that name for it. He said, because what people, that implies that people do things that are useful. Utility sounds like useful. So they only want useful things. But that's not true. He said people make all kinds of stupid decisions that are not in their own interest if they were to think more about it. So he said, I think we should change the name of the term. Instead of calling it utility, which goes back to the English philosopher Jeremy Bentham, in his whole philosophy, utilitarianism, which kind of equated usefulness with happiness. Irving Fisher said, I think we should call it wantability. So he tried to coin a new word in the English language. And if you haven't heard this word, it's because you don't criticize yourself, because it's practically extinct. So I did a search of newspapers, ProQuest search, to see the term wantability. And I found that it spiked up in 1918. And it was a popular word for 20 or 30 years. And then it went through an exponential decay. And we just forgot about it. So we're back to we're back to a kind of free markets enthusiasm that pervades economics today. So the idea that George Akerlof and I wanted to emphasize is that the economic system does not work perfectly. It works perfectly to maximize, we could use Irving Fisher's term, things wantability, but not necessarily perfection for all things. So I could talk for hours on this, 'cause I've written a book about it. a lot of the things that go wrong in a free market system are harmless stupidities that that are amplified, because once somebody sees that you'll go for something, there will be market forces that drive you there. So one thing, George was sitting at an airport, my co-author, waiting for a plane. The plane was late, and it was frustrating. You're sitting there for hours. And he could smell a very nice baking odor. It was somebody baking cinnamon buns. And cinnamon has a nice odor that you can smell. And then he reflected on it. He says, you know what? There's some powerful economic force generating this. And that is, it works. If you set up, you bake some baked goods in the airport, and a lot of people are annoyed and frustrated, they're at a weak point. You can exploit that weak point. And you won't get into any trouble. You won't go to jail for this. You're making people fatter, maybe, but that's all. And so he said, you know what? It's like a law of nature. If you have any weakness, it will be exploited. And it's guaranteed. So we looked at a company that does this called Cinnabon. Now, I don't know if they've made it to Lithuania yet. They have not. You can be thankful. They sell a cinnamon bun, which is dripping with frosting. And it's 900 calories, which is practically half a day's worth of food. But why are they so successful? They've got branches in many countries around the world. I don't think they even know why they're so successful. They have sort of an instinct. It's a little bit their display and their motto. It's where they place these outlets, the smell that they produce in the area. Their motto is, life needs frosting. So if that appeals to you, I think it does. It's part of a whole picture that it's knocking down your defenses. You decided, I'm not going to buy that. But they give you your excuse. So a capitalist system, there's lots of experimentation with our marketing ideas, and only a few of them work well. But those that work well are replicated to the limit. And so that's the world we live in. Another example that we give in the book is about gambling machines, slot machines. Gambling machines were discovered in 1893. The inventor did not go down in history as a great inventor, but they had these things where you'd pull a lever, and then if you won, coins would come pouring out. It turned out to be addictive to some, maybe 10% of the population. Maybe most people don't really care, but some people, there's something in their brain that gets them stuck in a do loop of pulling the handle. I say stuck in a do loop. That's old computer analogy. They'll tell you, that they're addicted. They know they're addicted. You know, you say, why would you want to just pull this handle and all day? They can't explain it. I just, all my troubles disappear, and I'm just happy when I'm doing this. And you can say, don't you know that you've been losing consistently? Because you place lots of small bets. The law of averages is going to dominate. But they may even know that, but they can't escape from it. So by the end of the 1890s, slot machines were being heavily regulated because people could see their addictive power. So they're confined to certain places. But even so, the technology of slot machines has been improved. So Natasha Schull wrote a book called Addicted by Design, describing all of the technology. The smart people have gone into making more addictive slot machines. One thing they've done is optimize the time between bets. It turns out that it's most effective if it's between 1 and 2 seconds between bets. You're just betting again and again and again and again. Somehow you just can't stop once you start. Then they discovered that if you get a payout, that's the time that people stop. It used to be coins would come pouring out. Then you'd have to gather them up. And it gave you a few seconds to reflect and say, I better stop now. So they discovered, eliminate that. Eliminate the coins coming out. It'll just say, you've won, and you've got a credit to your account. So, and it works. People don't stop. They keep betting, and they lose it. They lose it. We think that this is a model for a lot of other things that happen, of manipulations and deception. And once they start to work, they continue to work. So let me talk about the financial crisis of 2007 to 2009. This, like other financial crises, is substantially to be blamed on manipulation and deception. So during this financial crisis, when I spoke to many audiences, there were two questions that kept coming up. They'd ask me these questions. I'm talking about, let's go back to 2008 or 2009. They asked me, why wasn't the crisis predicted? Okay, that's the first question. The second question, why didn't anybody go to jail for this? I would sometimes protest that I predicted the crisis, but it's true that I was rather diffident myself, and not many people did. So what are the answers to these questions? Why wasn't the crisis predicted? Well, a good part of the answer is manipulation and deception. People who were involved in creating the crisis were trying to cover it up and trying to, it was in some cases even a conspiracy to cover up the danger. And secondly, why didn't anyone go to jail? Well, I think this attests for the professionalism of modern business, the quality of our lawyers, and the idea that people want to stay within the law. You know, you can make a lot of money without breaking the law, and your lawyers will help you. So it's legal. Moreover, it's not even that immoral, because everybody else is doing it anyway. And you have the possibility of saying to yourself, I had to do this to stay in business, but my business is important. I have employees who are dependent on me. I have family members. So you have outs that I wanted to give a couple of particular examples of people in business who were the most likely to go to jail, but are fine people anyway. Most people have many dimensions, and I don't like to demonize anyone, even if that person actually did go to jail. So I'll mention a couple of names. I've never met both of these people, and my apologies to their friends and families. One of them in the United States was Michael Milken. This is actually a previous crisis. Ever heard of him? Well, Michael Milken actually did go to jail. But you know what he's doing now? He's a philanthropist. They didn't confiscate all of his money. They made him pay huge fines as well as go to jail. And they didn't confiscate all of his money. And he's giving it away now. He has something called the Milken Foundation, Milken Institute. And you may go there someday to a conference. You might meet him. He's a nice guy. But he was the worst of them during the saving and loan crisis. So what he did is he became the junk bond king. He graduated from the Wharton School. He wrote his essay there about junk bonds. And there was a professor there, W. Braddock Hickman, who had written a book about junk bonds. Junk bonds are bonds issued by companies that are very unreliable and dangerous. They might well default. But Hickman showed that historically they've been a great investment because people are overly worried about this prospect. They usually pay out fine. And so he went on and became the junk bond king. And in the process became fabulously wealthy. But we fault him for a sort of what might seem like a minor moral transgression. And the minor transgression was that junk bonds today in 1975 are not the same as the junk bonds that Hickman studied. These are junk bonds that were created by my cronies, Mike Milken's friends. It was not that ethical, actually, at the time. But people, they get the idea, I'm playing a game. Business is a big game. I'm within the law, my lawyers, there's nobody asking me to point out that junk bonds today in 1975 are not the same as the so-called fallen angels that Hickman studied, and that my statistics is questionable. No one, that's a subtlety. I can't be thrown in jail for that. Well, I said Milken was thrown in jail, but not for that. For other things, he got a little bit careless about what he did. It's this idea that I'm playing a game, that everybody else is doing it, and I can't be that faulted. So my other example from the recent financial crisis, again, someone I've never met, and I'm sure he's a wonderful person, but you might not think so wonderfully about him if you were on the other side of some of his financial transactions. His name is Fabrice Tour. That's a French name, but he was operating in the United States at Goldman Sachs. He was the promoter of the Abacus bonds, which were involved, related to synthetic credit default obligations and were vulnerable to a possible decline in home prices. What ended up happening is the bonds defaulted, and it caught the IKB, Landesbank in Germany, and other ACA capital. They lost billions by having invested in these bonds. And Mr. Tour was criticized for not making it obvious, or not telling the buyers of these securities that they were constructed cynically. They were with the help of John Paulson, whose company, Paulson and Company, made $15 billion in 1 year in 2008. That's a pretty good turnaround for a company. What they did is they put together the worst bonds into a portfolio, the ones that would suffer the most if home prices fall. And they didn't. The buyers of the bonds weren't told by Mr. Tour that the bonds were subject to default. So what happened during the hearings? Mr. Tour absolved himself, and he said, "Look, the buyers of these bonds were all professionals. I didn't sell to the retail public. And they should know. Do I have to tell them that home prices might fall?" Nobody thought home prices would fall because they've never fallen. Well, not since in the United States, not since the Great Depression. And that's so long ago, can't be relevant. So do I have to point out that my creative spirit tells me that maybe it's different this time? No, I'm not responsible for that. That's what he said, something like that. What it was is that he again had this sense, I'm playing a game, there are rules to this game, and I'm within the rules. And these guys are grown-ups. They're professionals. They have their experts. It's their fault. But actually, the court in the United States didn't buy that. And they gave him a fine of something like $800 million. He'd made a lot of money off of this, by the way. But they didn't send him to jail. It wasn't quite criminal. And instead, he went to the University of Chicago Graduate School of Business, and the Graduate School, and is getting his PhD in economics right now. You might meet him somewhere. I'm sure he's a wonderful person. But you know, some people, this is the worst extreme during the Fabrice Tour is the example. If you wanted to pick of someone who might have gone to jail, it would be him, but he didn't go to jail. He's doing just fine. And I don't think that he's even evil at all. I think it's just a kind of an attitude that develops in a free market, in a phishing equilibrium. The thing that he said that's most famous, he sent an email to his girlfriend and quoting him word for word, this is his email back in 2008. "I've managed to sell a few abacus bonds to widows and orphans I met at the airport." So this was brought up in his trial that he said that. And he said, "I'm just joking." You can't send someone to jail for saying a joke to his girlfriend. So, but you can get a sense of the atmosphere there. So, and just in concluding, I wanted to say that what George Akerlof and I are doing in this book is not really so much criticizing free markets as observing how actual free market economies really work. So we have in our book not only talks about people who might have gone to jail, but talk about heroes. And we believe that heroes are the source of the strength of the free market system. There are always people who are like the after. There was a before and after Fabrice Tour. And a before and after Mike Milken. And they're both wonderful people now. They had a bad period in their life. So there's a lot of people who stand up against little things that are wrong and prevent the phishing equilibrium from getting even worse. The problem is that the kind of heroes that I'm talking about don't get very famous. So we don't even know they existed. But they have the satisfaction of knowing that they did something to offset the phishing equilibrium. Now, there's another thing about our book. George and I had lots of arguments writing this book, but I kept saying we should be less American-centric in our book. And we talk too much about Americans. But George said, we don't know how to talk about non-Americans. And foreign readers, they don't mind us. We're criticizing America. So what difference does it make? And he said, we don't talk credibly about Europe or Asia. So we kind of balance it. We try to do our best at not being U.S.-centric. But one thing we do is have a list of heroes. And I think all of our heroes are from America. Sorry about that. I was embarrassed when I first gave a talk in the U.K. about this, and I listed our heroes. And it turns out they all had UK counterparts who came earlier. So, but when I give this talk in the United States, I like to give a little set of questions. I list some of our heroes, and I ask someone in the audience, anyone, to identify these people. I guess I won't play this game because not many of you are Americans. But the Americans come up zero anyway. If you recognize any of my heroes' names, I'll be amazed. I just gave a book talk on this book in Atlanta, Georgia, a couple days ago. And they came up absolutely zero. And these were economists at a conference. So I'm just going to list a few heroes because I've been talking about not scoundrels, wonderful people who had bad periods earlier in their life when they didn't have business ethics foremost. So I asked Americans, can anybody identify the following name? Florence Kelly. See, now I don't expect you could raise your hand and tell me who she was. And zero Americans can too. But she was famous in her day. In 1899, she set up something called the National Consumers League. And they would test products that were unsafe, and they would put a white label, National Consumers League white label, on the product if it passed the test. So you haven't heard of her. Alice Lakey, okay, another once famous American. Absolutely nobody in America remembers her anymore. And she had a colleague, Harvey Washington Wiley. Right? No one's heard of him. What they did is created something in the United States called the Food and Drug Administration, which tested drugs carefully and would forbid selling dangerous or even just useless drugs. They made a huge revolution. Back then, most medicines you'd buy at a pharmacy were frauds. It was just all fraud. Examples, there was a medicine called Swaim's Panacea. What does panacea mean? It's a drug for everything. Could you believe this? He said, my medicine cures everything. That is idiocy. I mean, at the first face of it, there is no such thing. These people managed to create the Food and Drug Administration in the United States in 1906. So then, when I gave this talk in London, I thought, I better check whether they did this. Sure enough, Parliament in the UK passed a Pure Food and Drugs Act in 1897. And there were some UK heroes behind that, some chemists who... So I tried it out on UK audience. Do you know, I don't even remember their names anymore, but they were there. And nobody remembers them. William Henry Merrill, I'm sure none of you have heard of him. He was the electrician who was asked to inspect the electronics at the 1893 World's Fair in Chicago. In 1893, electricity was just the most exciting thing. It was coming. You still were working with candles, but you knew that before too many years, your home would get electricity. So the people wanted to see electric things. But the problem was, they weren't done right, and they were dangerous. So he got really upset. He said, all these people doing bad electric work. So he started a nonprofit called Underwriters Laboratories. And they would inspect and certify the safety of things. This is not government regulation. The government wasn't involved. It was nonprofit, and it was public-spirited. So he comes across as one of our heroes. By the way, this is an interesting development. Underwriters Laboratories is still in business, and if you look at your laptop or something, you might still see their UL symbol. But they've become for-profit. And about 10 years ago, they found it was difficult to raise money for their projects as a nonprofit, so they did a switch from nonprofit to for-profit. But they're the same company, and they still have an ethical drive. So I'll stop with one more example. Tell me if you've heard of this person, Bill Gates. Some of you have heard of him. Now, he is a guy. I'll ask you another question. Have you ever felt angry with Microsoft Corporation? Probably. So Bill Gates was not always the nicest guy. He was not Mike Milken or Fabrice Tour, but he now is one of the biggest philanthropists in the world. So what do you make of that? I think it's... this gets on to the fundamental dilemma of a free market society. Bill Gates was allowed by free market laws to become one of the richest men in the world. Was that good or bad? And he became playing hardball. Oh, I should mention, Bill Gates is now a disciple of Andrew Carnegie, who was one of the richest men in America in the 19th century, and who wrote a book called The Gospel of Wealth. An audacious title, making it sound like a religion. But Andrew Carnegie was a very moralizing person who said that in business, it's important that your business purposes are ultimately for society. And what he said you should do is plan on retiring at age 50 or 55 and spending the rest of your life giving it away, which he did. He retired from business about age 55. He set up the Carnegie Foundation, Carnegie Hall, Carnegie Institute of he put his name on them, but they were all philanthropic ventures. So this is what Bill Gates has been advocating. He asks billionaires, if there's any billionaires in the audience, you are asked by Bill Gates to sign a giving pledge to do what Andrew Carnegie did. But life is like that, the sense that a free market system produces great wealth, but it produces moral dilemmas that we all have to... I think that it also produces heroes. It's not a direct product, but it's given the human nature that people really do, really are not fully selfish. They don't exist, except for maybe some mental illness anomalies. Normal human people have an aggressive, competitive side, but they also have a humane and social side. And the capitalist system works well because it recognizes this complexity of human nature, but also because some of the people are heroes. I'll stop with that. And we have time for questions.
Thank you very much for this interesting presentation. And we'll take questions from the audience. It's a small room, so there will be no microphone. I would like to be impolite and to take an opportunity to ask the first question. I had a conversation just as I had returned from the United States to Lithuania in 2009 with a friend of mine who's a philosopher of a libertarian bent, a highly intelligent person, and a smoker. And of course, I initially, we spoke about all sorts of limitations on smoking ads and placing cigarettes next to the checkout counters, much like candy.
Well, they used to do that, yes.
They still do that in Lithuania now.
Oh, they do?
Yeah.
It's gone in America.
He gave me lots of arguments, of which I didn't buy any, but he gave me lots of arguments that, in fact, smoking was his right. If he wanted to die young, that was his prerogative. And in fact, by dying young, he was saving money for the National Health Service. I guess my point is that if you hired somebody who is sufficiently clever and can talk fast, you probably can make counter-arguments to cinnamon buns, to candy at the counters, and perhaps even to financial instruments that people find unethical. So my question would be this. Is it possible to talk about any kind of overall regulation, as opposed to these private attempts, which are noble and fine, but if they fail, then they fail. If they succeed, they succeed. They're not required for everyone. Is it possible to talk about the overarching regulation in a truly liberal society where everybody's free to have their concept of what is good and useful?
Right.
Or should there be instead some debate about the common good, which is very difficult to imagine nowadays?
Yeah, well, okay, this is a very complicated question. Well, I guess when we're coming up with a new book, we get into gray areas. It is true that one of the beauties of capitalism is that it lets people do their own thing and make their own decision. And the idea of having a paternalistic government decide for you doesn't seem so good. Now, one thing is we tend to have laws that distinguish people by their expertise. And when you talk about people who prey on the mentally retarded, for example, you might feel different. Some people are deficient. They have brain damage. Something's not right. So we have different rules for them. Now, let's not just talk about mentally retarded. What about the other side? in the United States, we've long had rules that are different for accredited investors and ordinary investors. So in U.S. law, you are an accredited investor if you have income over $200,000, if you're single, over $200,000 a year, or wealth not including your home of over, I think it's $2 million. They have special rules for you that make it easier for you to do things. So for example, what is a hedge fund in the United States? A hedge fund is an investment company that does work only with accredited investors. Part of the law says if you're selling to accredited investors, you cannot advertise. That's why you never see an ad by a hedge fund. I was asking a hedge fund manager to talk to my class at Yale, and I said it would be recorded. It might be up on the web. He said, oh, no, I can't do that. I'm a hedge fund operator. That could be advertising. And so he pulled out. So is that the right way to split things up? The problem is even the accredited investor, they're not really that different from the rest of us. They can be fooled and tricked, too. So sometimes you know that someone is running a business that's really deceitful. The people who independently come and look at it say, this is based on trickery. Even if it is for the IKB Landesbank in Germany, maybe they weren't as professional as they thought they were, or they thought they could trust the Americans or something like that. So I think it's filled with gray areas and human judgment. But I think that we've learned. The same thing, should someone be allowed to sell Swaim's Panacea now? Do we let people judge for themselves? If you allow them to sell it, it'll probably work again. They'll get customers again. But most people in this room would immediately recognize it as a fraud. So it's a question of where you draw the line. We need heroes to sort these things out for us and help us sort them out.
All right, thank you.
Vladis.
Vladis, Ashes. Probably the biggest investment in our lives is education, and it's a huge part of the economy with that concept of how much the manipulation and deception are in the field of education, especially in the business education.
That's a good, actually, George and I argued about this. I wanted to add an education chapter, and he didn't want to. I wanted to add a religion chapter, too. he didn't want me to do. I thought some churches do phishing, but okay, we won't. we didn't do it. Maybe it's because we didn't want to bite the hand that feeds us. I don't know. But there are lots of games played in academia. I don't know where to begin. but there is also an idealistic side. So universities tend to be somehow descendants of churches. In fact, the ISM campus is on a former monastery. So what does that say to me? It says to me that there is some idealistic side. And people might at some point act cynically about the idealized purpose of a university. But down deep, there is a sense of respect. I think it's part of humanity. I think it's a human universal to have some concern for one's integrity. And so I don't know what you wanted me to say about education. It has some academic education has a phishing problem, too. Namely that they put, let's think of professors. They put young assistant professors in a highly competitive situation. You're trapped because you can't start all over and learn some different area. So you're stuck with it. And in fact, as time goes on, you have like 2 years left before your tenure decision. And you think, you know, this research is really, I don't believe it anymore at all. But maybe it's right. I'm going to try to do the best I can. That's not the right incentive scheme for a young professor. We could talk about students, too. Maybe they worry too much about grades. Maybe you're phishing when you spend time developing, getting good grades and not developing yourself as a human person. But we didn't talk about it in the book.
If you don't mind, I'll cut myself out as a middleman. I'll let you take the questions. It's a small room. We have about 20 minutes.
All right. Yeah.
Thank you for your very nice, interesting presentation. My name is Aurimas Peretnis. I'm from News Radio here in Vilnius. I'm a journalist.
From where?
From radio station. I'm a journalist in News Radio, Žinių Radijas, here in Vilnius. And my question regarding these manipulations, and we have the decentralization of discourse. We have very intensive comments, and the world is changing. But what do you see the future world? Because if today we have the world of some kind of devaluation of truth, what do you see the future age will look like?
When you say devaluation of truth, give me an example.
A lot of interpretations, and everybody could give you the truth. A lot of microphones, a lot of speakers. What will look next age?
Well, first of all, you asked the most difficult question. You asked me to tell you what the next age will look like. You're also bringing up a theme that I've just been seeing repeatedly in the last month or so about post-factual democracy or post-factual society. Someone invited me to a conference in Copenhagen about it. I'm not going, but there is an interesting conference on it in Copenhagen. The Economist magazine, maybe it's the current issue. You read The Economist, it's a good magazine. It talked about post-factual society. So what they're this is an important new development, but what they're commenting on is the decline of established interpreters of the news in favor of bloggers and at the same time a kind of conspiracy theory that the news media can't be trusted. In the United States particularly, associated with the followers of Donald Trump. Do you know who I'm talking about? it'd be better if you hadn't heard of him. Why have you heard about Donald Trump and you haven't heard about Alice Lakey? It's something. Donald Trump and his followers have a conspiracy theory, which is that the liberal media, that's all the media, the newspapers are all in a conspiracy to deceive the American people. And Donald Trump is a courageous man who is standing up and saying it as it really is, saying things like Muslims are the source of our problems, or Barack Obama is the source of all of our problems. You can tell that I'm not a Trump supporter. Here I am, though, talking about him because he comes to mind. So the idea is, there was a website called Politico, I was just reading it the other night, that had 100 lies that Trump has purveyed. One of them is Barack Obama is not legally president of the United States because the Constitution says it's limited to people who were born physically in the United States. And he was born in Kenya, Africa. Well, that is a lie because the birth certificate office will announce as many times, no, he was born in Hawaii. You can even go to old newspapers and there was a birth announcement published in the newspaper. And then another thing, would any American mother go to Kenya to have her baby? That is ridiculous. Healthcare was not greatest in 1950-something in Kenya. You wouldn't go there to have your baby. So it's just ridiculous. And they try to get Donald Trump to admit, and he won't. It was just in the news this morning that his campaign manager admitted Obama was born in America. But Trump still will not, because he knows that his followers believe that. They believe all of these stories and that it's a conspiracy. So this may not just be in the United States. Brexit has been blamed on this kind of politicking. Trump won't admit that he's wrong on so many factual things, because he represents a new brand of politics. Well, it's not entirely new. You can think of other examples from history. But what you do is you create examples that get people angry, stories of atrocities, maybe false stories. So Donald Trump tells stories about Mexican immigrants coming in and raping American women. Well, but the statistics show that they are not any more rapists than anybody else. He just doesn't care. He just keeps saying it because people imagine that we're under this Mexican threat. So that's post-factual democracy. The problem is that you can't counteract it, because you have to come up with another story that that has the same word-of-mouth potential. I keep talking about, sorry about my American centric. I come here saying I'm really Lithuanian, but I can't help giving American examples because I live there and it's all around it. But I think it's a broader phenomenon that post-factual society is more of a problem than it's been in much of history. Well, actually, if you really go far back in history, we didn't have newspapers until after the year 1600. And life must have been really chaotic when there were no professional news media. So we're heading back to those times. They're called feudal times or medieval times. Yeah.
I may be disappointed that we talk about Donald Trump, because I had a discussion with my wife about him, and I really thought I would have at least a few hours to forget about him. That's just a side comment. But coming back to your book, when you talk about, in your speech, you were talking about theory blind deception or manipulation. So let me be a bit provocative, because I'm a candy and chocolate manufacturer, and of course you really heard.
You are, me. Really?
Yes, I am really. And I'm very proud of it.
I'm probably one of your customers.
I hope so. I mean, basically everybody is in one or the other way. But why I'm asking you, about, is it really manipulation or is it optimization in a sense when you put the products there? It's because it's not only about my products, it's about I have to defend my coworkers in a large industry. Is it really about manipulation or is it going to the optimum? Because behind our chain there are other people, so we optimize in our terms, and I'm just provoking it. Because, so I would like to know, how are you sure that it's not this blind? What is it here, blindness you're implementing here, or blindness?
This reminds me, when I came to Lithuania in 1974, it was my first trip. One of my relatives here had sent a letter from a 14-year-old girl, some relative of mine, who I'm actually seeing again now, years later. So I brought bubble gum for her, because I was told that they do not sell bubble gum in Lithuania as part of the Soviet Union. Am I correct on that? I think that's the word I got. And because the Soviet authorities thought, bubble gum, what do we need of that? It's one of those little pleasures. So I was I being wrong to bring candy into Lithuania back then? So it's filled with gray area. I think candy is part of the pleasures of living. And thank you for making it available. What I was talking about was balance in life. And do you really want to be confronted with candy? Now, maybe you do. Maybe you think at the end of a shopping trip, I need a candy bar, and it's helpful if they provide them right there. So it's a gray area. I know there's lots of gray areas.
Well, I'm not talking about that one, because I take it what you said, but it's more for me in your book, as you talk about the theory, how you can follow through or write this book with your colleague and eliminate this potential blindness of the theory you build up. How do you work with that one?
Well, I think we live in a world that we are, humans are a product of evolution. And we, our brains are like computers, and they have a built-in hardwired program. And also, they learn. We load programs as well. But the hardwired program has certain problems. So for example, there's something called the affect heuristic, which was a term coined by psychologist Paul Slovak in this century, maybe 15 years ago. What is the affect heuristic? He's thinking, what does the word heuristic mean, by the way? You might not know it. In psychology, it's a brain shortcut. The brain has a processing. This comes back to thinking fast and slow. The brain has a processing system of limited bandwidth, or what's the right computer term? So it has to do shortcuts. You can't process everything. The affect heuristic is a hardwired switch in your brain that decides that when your emotions are running high, and maybe time is of the essence, it shortcuts your decision making around your intellectual centers into more rapid response mode. It's a heuristic, meaning it's a shortcut for certain circumstances. But it may apply more generally. So the affect heuristic is when you are feeling strong emotions, you have an impulse to make quick, fast decisions that are not well thought out. It's a bug, and it's exploitable. There's different kinds of emotions. It's not always quick and fast decisions, but it influences your decision. So I have a recent paper with a couple of my colleagues at Yale about how people view things in response to crisis. So we have data on people's estimated probability of a stock market crash. And we were able to get the exact date that they gave their probability and their exact postal code, so we knew exactly where they were. So we found that if there was an earthquake within 30 miles of their location, that they gave a higher probability of a stock market crash. Now, this is crazy, because if you had an earthquake locally, why should you give a higher probability of a worldwide stock market crash? It makes no sense. But that's the affect heuristic. It's a brain bug, as Buonamano calls it. It's a flaw in the program. It wasn't a flaw originally. It's a workaround. The program isn't perfect. So we tend to be affected by emotions, even in making important decisions. And advertisers know this and attempt to exploit this. Most advertising on television, I actually haven't watched your television. I don't know what. But in the US, it's little skits. They have actors pretending like you. They know the demographic. They know whether you're old or young. So if you're young, if it's a TV show watched by young people, they'll have young actors, etc. And they act out little skits from everyday life to really make it resonant with you. And they try to stir certain emotions and associate it with their product. This is marketing. It's working around a brain bug. Now, candy manufacturers, anyway, do you advertise?
Yes.
You feel good about the whole
the whole thing? I feel good about it.
Yes.
Of course.
Okay. You're making people happy with your...
We talk afterwards a bit more. Yes, I feel happy about
it.
A great presentation, thank you very much. I would like to ask a question regarding crisis. I met actually you first time in 2013 at the embassy of Lithuania in Washington, D.C.
Yeah,
and at that time you mentioned that you've spotted a real estate bubble in Brazil, and Brazil is not a big fan of yours after that. Could you comment maybe on the current developments? In general, in the world, in the economics. What can you see, what's going on?
By the way, I was right about Brazil.
Yeah, you were. That's why they don't like you.
They haven't invited me back.
So, maybe not about Lithuania. Of course, Lithuania is the the interesting part, but in general in the world, can you see a brief forecast in like near future?
You want me to forecast the markets?
Yes, if you could please. Like, what can you say, the major developments? Your opinion.
Okay, well, I'm not necessarily authoritative. This is my, I'll give you a tilt toward my unique take on it. I personally think that our affect, our emotions, and our decision-making at this point in history, and by our, I mean anybody in the world, is affected by the internet or the technology revolution that's going so fast right now. And I think that young people all over the world are worried about their careers. What will I be doing in 10, 20, 30 years? I like to tell my students at Yale that you have a 100-year horizon. Think of the year 2116. You might not be still alive then, but you might, because medical technology is moving ahead. But at least your children or grandchildren will be alive yet. So you care about 2116. But what is life going to be like in 2116? We were asked yesterday by Grybauskaitė at the government conference to predict Lithuania or Europe in 2040. That's 25 years in the future. It's very hard to predict. I think technology is changing so fast. And I think it's not something that people talk about. They pretty commonly talk about it, but I don't think that the talk conveys the amount of affect that is generated by the thought of this new technology. The problem is, I mean, I could put this is my my mobile phone. I could ask it to answer your questions. And it might. You know, this thing answers questions. Unfortunately, your questions are a little too difficult for this at this point in history. But what will it be like in 30, 50, or 100 years? I think people have a fundamental angst about that. And the affect is one of uncertainty, of lack of knowledge about who am I. I'll give you another silly example. When I was a teenager, I learned all of the stars in the sky, and I could point to a star, and I'll tell you how far away it is. I thought I could impress, it never impressed anybody, really. But for all I did. But now I have it on this thing. It's called Google Sky, and you turn it on, you hold it up, and it tells you exactly the name of the star. Then you can ask, you can talk to it and say, tell me about Lambda Draconis, and it will tell you how far away it is. This thing has already replaced me on that skill. So you wonder, what am I doing in an education? These things are getting so I used to memorize facts, but what good is that? This thing has already replaced me. So where is it going? And I think that people don't know, and they're worried. So what it does is it increases the saving rate from what it would otherwise be. It makes them reluctant to spend money. And it also may result in bid up of asset prices to high level. But it's not consistently doing that. Europe is not, the stock markets in Europe are not highly priced. US is highly priced. I think it's, but it may stay there for a long time. We have the zero interest rate regime, which I think is tied to this. Why are interest rates so low? It's because people want to save. They're thinking, I've got to do something because I may be out of a job in 20 years or I won't be positioned well. So we're living in a time when you see these rare examples of internet. I'm glad you're teaching IT here as part of your, did I get that right? Yeah. We see these internet pioneers who developed some new website, and now they're billionaires overnight. But most of us aren't going to do that. We don't know how to do that. So we feel like we're worried about our future, about being left out. What do you do? Well, you can get a graduate degree. That sounds like the right thing to do. But nobody feels safe. Nobody knows what jobs are going to be replaced. I will always be eating candy. That's not going away. Well, maybe it will, though. I have to think about that. You never know. The artificial, but you could switch to that, right? If it became artificial sweeteners were recommended, you could do that.
Of course, it's just recipe
changes. Yeah, okay. But you're pretty secure. But you never know. I won't anyway. Right back there, yeah.
I'd like to play devil's advocate. I haven't read your book yet. I'm looking forward to doing so. But from what I understand, what you're trying to say is that by pushing the threshold of morality, people have a better chance of doing well within the system.
You say threshold of
morality.
Well, I think we need morality, and I think I hope you at ISM have some business ethics in your curriculum. I'm looking at you.
Yeah.
The question is whether the system inherently rigs people to become worse people.
To become worse?
Worse people. Because if the way to win is actually to be a bit less moral, like you put the cinnamon at the right place at the right time,
yeah,
to trigger you to buy.
Right.
To create more addictive.
Well, that is essentially the theme of our book. Without the phishing equilibrium is an equilibrium that you can't get out of, because it's an equilibrium. Everyone else is doing it. The only way you can get out of it is through some kind of collective action. So it takes different forms. The weakest form is you set up a chamber of commerce or some kind of business organization where you have regular meetings and you just talk about business ethics. That has some impact. But then the Chamber of Commerce will lobby members of parliament for laws that punish people who violate ethical standards. That helps more, because then it's possible to be profitable and adhere to moral standards. The one thing that's hard to do is to be an individual business that says, I'm not going to put candy bars at the checkout counter, even though everybody else does it, and there's no human outcry. There's no newspapers publishing articles about it. And you just pretty much can't do that. Yeah?
A short question about the book. Who do you intend to be your primary audience, primary readers, like average Joes who are the fish? Fools, or who
needs
to be informed, or
I don't know. George and I were thinking about ourselves as teenagers. And it turns out that both he and I read a book, as teenagers, by Vance Packard called The Hidden Persuaders, which was about marketing. And we both remember, I think we remember the same page. There was one page in that book describing marketing of cake mixes. And the story that Vance Packard told was cake mix manufacturers were able to make a very good cake mix where the instructions were add water, stir, bake. They discovered later that if they were to change that and make it more difficult, the new thing says, add water and one egg, stir and bake. Sales went up. But so how can that be? So they tested it to see if anyone could tell the difference. It doesn't matter whether you use dried egg or a fresh egg. Nobody can tell the difference. So why does it sell more if you make it harder? And they decided it was psychology. And that was women, it was mostly women who did cake mixes, especially back then. It didn't fit into her role as a loving mother or wife to be doing something so simple. An egg sounds healthy and good. So that's fishing. But there's nothing really strongly immoral about this. It's part of a fishing equilibrium. Did I answer?
Let's try to, since we are running out of time, let's try to wrap this up if possible. I see one more question in the end.
Yeah.
So a brief clarification, then that question, and then that's it.
Oh, you can still clarify?
Yes,
but you were clarifying.
Pretty much stays the same. So who should read your book?
Well, so I guess we kind of wrote it to our imagined teenage selves. Now, economists never, the book Vance Packard's Hidden Persuaders, which you might read, was really an interesting book. Lots of interesting passages about what marketing was doing back then in the 1950s. Who should read? The one people who don't read Vance Packard is economists. It's not talked about among economists. So I don't know how to. I think there's another trend abroad in economics and maybe in academics that there is more scholarly trade publishing. If you go back 50 years, professors of economics considered it beneath their dignity to write books for the general public. It was embarrassing. They wouldn't do it. But now it's much more common. We had a session at our American Economic Association meetings about scholarly trade publishing as a new trend. So I think that who are we writing for with this book? We are. We'd really like to write it for our fellow economists, but they won't read it unless this goes. Otto Eckstein, who is a professor at Harvard, wrote a book called The Great Recession. He wrote that in 1978, and it was aimed. By the way, The Great Recession was the 1974-75 recession. He named it, and then it got recycled to be the 1981-82 recession, and now it got recycled again to be the 2007-2009 recession. So I think the definition, what is the Great Recession? It's the most recent recession. So, but he told me, that Otto Eckstein, that he wrote his book for the economics profession because the only way to get them to read it is to give it, to get the general public reading it. I think there's a certain insight and wisdom there. It has something to do with academic phishing, and academics tend sometimes to be overly insular and inbred. And I think that it is possible, now it's increasingly possible now though, to write scholarly papers. Now as president of the American Economic Association, I was organizing our annual meetings, and I had a feeling, looking at the many papers we had submitted, that there is really a more practical, down-to-earth side to economics now than there was 20 years ago or more. So I think some economists will read this. That was always our hope.
Okay. One last question there in the corner.
I would like to ask about this deception that you're talking about. Is it in any way morally wrong if nobody is pointing a gun or forcing them to do something that they would like, that they want?
Yeah. So you would, Fabrice Thor should have brought you in his defense. He was, well, anyway, he didn't go to jail, you know. He didn't commit a crime. He was offering products, and people could look at them, and he didn't cover up anything. Well, maybe he did. Maybe that's why he had to pay a fine. But it was not quite criminal. It's a fundamental question that you in business, when you're trading, when you have a job as a trader, you have knowledge. Should you, are you morally compelled to tell people your knowledge, or do you just trade on it? Now, this is a gray area, but I think it is okay to trade on your knowledge without announcing it to the world, because you've worked to get this knowledge, and you can stand to benefit from it. The ethical problems are not simple. That's why we need graduate courses where these problems are worked out. But I don't. Again, I don't think that very many people are evil. We have people called psychopaths, or is that the word, sociopaths. The Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of the American Psychiatric Association says that about 3% of males in the United States have antisocial personality disorder. And if it's 3%, And I assume that's true everywhere, not just America.
More in politics.
More in politics. So there are people who are, again, I think of neuroscience as the science of our age. Our brain has certain built-in connections which are human universals, except in certain people with defects who end up in prison a lot, actually. They get end up, sadly, being removed from society. But the rest of us have an impulse. It's perfectly normal to have a sense, I am a good person and I'm proud of it. Criminals do. Most criminals in jail, if you interview them, will tell the interviewer that they have a morality. They have justifications. They've thought them through. Why did you steal this from the store? They'll say, well, this store manager is a rich man. He's oppressing. They may not put it so eloquently, but he's in cahoots with other criminals in our government. There's a whole defense story. So it's not that most criminals are without morals. It ends up being evaluating the justification for something, and it ends up on subtleties that require serious thought.
Thank you very much. I was going to thank, but now there is actually one more
very special thing. Delivery.
Yes.
Dear Professor, you are coming fifth time to Lithuania. We are giving you a brand new passport from Lithuania. That's okay. 3 years' work by Kestutis Pikunas and team on the front page, Jonas Mekas, and it's a lot to read about the people, stories, ideas. So thank you for sharing.
All right.
And
thank
best
you.
Regards from all global Lithuanian.
Thank you.